We're now called to order, Port Arthur Independent School Board trustee meeting for March 23rd, 2017. We will follow the agenda as our printed, the invocation by, since Mr. Bartier is in here, we will have Mr. Robert Reed, pledge of the United States and Texas flags in the roll call. First, I have a Port Arthur, would like to say something.
Good evening to all of you. During our prayer, I will ask Mr. Reed to remember two of our students, one former and one from last week, from a teacher, from Thomas Jefferson. Thomas Jefferson, a student who passed away last Saturday, Malcolm Preston, and then Justin Gilbert, a former Memorial student from a couple of last year. So I want to thank Memorial High School for their contribution to the family, which was very, very generous. So we thank you. We keep the family in prayer. Also, we want to keep in prayer the family of Dr. Maddie Londo. Dr. Londo was with us Monday night and has suffered an illness. And please keep her family in our prayers as well.
Ladies and gentlemen, before I begin prayer, I ask that we observe a moment of silence in memory of the two young people, our family, our children, that we lost this week. And right now we know that they are with our Heavenly Father in His arms resting. But I ask that we all observe just a brief moment of silence in memory. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to serve our community, to serve your children. We ask that you always be with the people who work for us, our teachers, our custodians, our maintenance workers, our administrators. Lord, provide them with strong mind, strong body, each day to carry out your will. Lord, I also ask that you bless each one of us as board members. Help us to make sound decisions and help us always keep in mind that we are here to serve you and your children. And I ask all this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Honor Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state under God, one and indivisible.
When I have a roll call, Ms. Davis.
President Lofton.
Here.
Vice President Bartee. Secretary Ambrose. Trustee Frank.
Here.
Trustee Guillory.
Here.
Trustee Kinlaw. Trustee Reed.
Here.
We do have a quorum. Our mission statement. Our mission as the primary source of public education in the community is to meet the unique educational needs of our diverse population by providing a comprehensive quality education for the students of Port Arthur Independent School District. We will now have the FCCLA student presentation by Ms. Jean Goss, the FCCLA advisor.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Lofton. FCCLA stands for Family, Career, and Community Leaders of America. Our students have done a remarkable job. This is Goss makes sure that I get a lot of information and is always bragging rights for her. So that is a great thing. We love when our children do well. Also today she has Mr. David Wall, who is the co-sponsor of FCCLA, I gotta get that right. So we are happy. So we would ask Mrs. Goss And Mr. Wall, if you would come forward and just tell us a little bit about what our students are doing and what they will do this evening.
He backed out on me. He said he was going first. I want to take just a second to tell you how much we appreciate you letting us come and present, let the kids present what they've been doing in their organization. And also to thank the superintendent, your staff, and this board for what you do for the school district. And you're kind of like always behind the scenes, the unseen hand, and you fight things for us and battles for us and make sure we have school and what we need. And we appreciate it so much and want to give you a big hand. He's already introduced the organization. This is our second year at Memorial High School with the organization. The first year, we only managed to make a local meeting, a leadership meeting that was local. We weren't able to go to the region. But this year, the kids hit it hard and strong, managed to get a vision to do competitions. The main thing about this organization is that it is co-curricular, and that is, it's not an extracurricular organization. I teach family and consumer science at Memorial High School, and the content that the kids do in the class, that's what the competitions are built around. So it's not something extra, it's the work that they're doing in class anyway. And also, it's eligible for Perkins funding whenever we need money. If the Perkins money is available, because the organizations are nationally and state recognized, they're eligible for Perkins funding. They involved with hands-on activities and it's project-based learning. And you're going to see that today with their presentations. They have a fall leadership meeting, a region meeting in Galveston, a state meeting that's in various major cities in Texas, and then if they make it there, they go to a national meeting, and it's held in a different city and a different state every year. So our kids that are presenting today actually placed for state when they went to the region meeting in February. There are a lot of scholarships attached to FCC at LA, and we're really excited about that for the students' chances to have those. If you want to know more about it, I also want to thank the technology department in our school district, and I appreciate the teacher website that you guys have made so that we can have access to it. And if you go to my teacher website on Memorial High School, there is actually a link for FCCLA there. You can see the national and state websites. Okay? And then Mr. David Wall has a couple of things.
I don't have much I'd like to say. This is my first year teaching at Memorial High School. I teach biology. And prior to coming to Memorial and Port Arthur ISD, I judged FCCLA events at the collegiate level. So I've seen this from the back. I've been involved in making sure that these kids are judged according to the level of work that they put in. And I've never seen a team like this come together so quickly and handle the pressure that is involved in going to regions. We had a team and individuals make it to the state level. I've never seen that. I've never taught at the high school level. So it's really great to be part of that. And I think that as we roll forward into next year, we're going to see that we're going to see students not only make it to the state level, but to the national level. So I hope you're looking forward to that. And I want to point out the fact that FCCLA is akin to, similar to UIL academic events, in that you have students who can get full ride scholarships and a myriad of monies and scholarships to go to college. So this is something that we get to build our students up with. They get to see not only that they have leadership potential at the high school level, but they also have scholarship funding available to go on into the college level and continue on with this. So with that being said, enjoy the presentations because they worked hard on this. Thanks.
And Amy, if you want to bring your group up.
Porter, can I say one more thing?
Yes.
You're spoiling them bad, because at competition level, they have to do everything. Nobody sets the technology up for them, anything. They're like loving this right now. But they have to do everything. They have to connect all their projectors, their computers, and so y'all spoiling them bad.
Well, great. You know, we like to say that our kids are with us. Our students are with us. We like to spoil them.
Yeah.
We try to tell them, though, when you get out to the real world, you have to be an adult, you have to grow up. But it is good to have them, we can still spoil them and do things for them, because you have a long time to be an adult. You're young just for a short period of time. It gives us pleasure to do as much as we can for them, as long as we can. So thank you, Mrs. Goss.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Aaliyah Charlotte.
And I'm Amy Sanchez, and this is our presentation that we brought to SCCLA Region Events. It is called The Power of Memorial Port Arthur, because for a small city, we have a lot of power in us. This is just a brief preview of our table contents about everything that we're going to cover and talk about in our slides. This is our SCCLA planning process summary page, which is required in order to be in competition. It basically just highlights what our concerns are, what we want to make possible at our school, what our goals are for the 2016-2017 and continuing following years. My identifying concerns, well, ours would be to keep SCCLA growing at Memorial High School. We are all seniors here today, but just because we're seniors, that does not mean that it has to end.
Okay, for our set of goal, we like to set a goal to train new members so they can have the same experience that we had, and so they can get the idea. So right now, how we're doing is so they can get an idea of how they'll be experienced in this group.
Our formal plan would be to make SCCLA not only a club, but a second family. Like, being here, meeting every Thursday, is making us grow together. We know things about each other, and we're all connected, and basically we're a second family.
Okay. I have to spread the word to join people, for people to join through announcements, flyers, and even having events. We are a stress-free environment where our students can come after a stressful day of school. No one to be judged on what they look like. We will personally talk to them and need like therapy so they can be trusted with us as friends.
And our follow-up would be, we would check what methods work, what methods don't work, see how the next group of kids will see, basically, this didn't work last year, let's see how we can improve it this year. This worked last year, let's keep this one going.
Okay, our membership campaigns, we always recruit members from CLA at Memorial, so we have like different events like our Summits of Success and also our TDS, Teens in the Driver's Seat. So have you heard about like some teens getting car crashes, dying? You don't want to hear that, right? So what we do, we promote teens and get them involved and show them that they're not supposed to do this, and to get them that idea that it's bad. And you also have drunk goggles, but it's kind of cloudy, and when you go like on this like walk path thing, they usually fall over. But they have a good time, and we got like a good fundraiser out of that. It was really fun.
And along with that, we also give them promo items such as wristbands, lanyards, candy, rings, things like that. Mainly what we want to appeal to them is, just because it's a club, it doesn't have to be serious. You can have fun with your friends, you can work on projects, you can expand your knowledge with our club.
Our meetings, being SCLA, attend meetings as possible. as many as possible. The more meetings you attend, the more information you get to get access in order to be the best you can be. Here are a couple of flashbacks that you see. In the first picture, you're seeing yourself, and there's another member in the group who, Kenesha Brown, and also Ms. Cox. And in that fall leadership at 216 Silsby was really fun. It was my first time being a CLA, and I got to experience and I wanted to join.
And these are just more pictures from the meetings that we have gone to. It shows us different activities, how to recruit more people, and we just have a good time with each other. These are our recognition activities. Basically, every month, we try to recruit more people. That way, the club doesn't die out as they go on through the years. We do honorable mentions on the school announcements, a gift card to any fast food joint or restaurant, and a pair of free movie tickets and a small popcorn for anyone who recruits the most members that month.
For our leadership activities, as for leadership activities, we let our officers pick what group must do for each month. Just this month, we had a cupcake sale at a local Petco. The officer in charge of this had to plan everything from who would participate to checking what the weather would be like on those days to for us to sell cupcakes. But we got a lot of money, we did very good, $400-something, which got us to Regions. Yeah, so I don't know about this time.
And these are more pictures from the cupcake sale.
And also, Ms. Goss's class had also joined in to help us. They baked cupcakes in their class place, it's a hospitality class. They baked cupcakes for us, so we don't have to do all that hard work, and we just went up there and just saw.
Our competitive events, as you all know, this was our first year going to Regions. And we are proud to say that we did place first state. This is basically our group and our awards that we won. We were all nervous, of course. We were kind of lost. We were like, you go here at this time, you go there, no, switch the times and everything. And even though we are a small city school, we have the heart of a lion. We are prepared to basically compete with everyone.
Our cooperative projects, teamwork makes the dream work. Being an SCLA means getting along with the people in your group to point out that they are like a second family. Cooperative is key, key in our success. So we have made a few projects to help us to work as a team. Some of these projects was be planning and organizing our team safety and driver seat, and seeing what our budget is currently is, and putting out different ideas and getting profit in, so we just at least go places.
These are our individualized activities. Although we are a group, it's important for us to work individually. Help the community see that we're out there, we're doing our fair share of work. That would include making sure a homeless person has eaten that day. That will cost you no more than $10, and it'll brighten their day up. That will make sure that they're happy and you get a good feeling out of it. There's also helping out at our local animal shelter and visiting lonely patients in a hospital. I know many of them don't have family members sometimes. And it just brightens their mood and it makes their day. And cleaning up the trash around the neighborhood.
Our community service activities. Unfortunately, for our kids surrounded by negative comments, it is important for us to show our flourishing positivity, and that's in our city. This year in April, we'll be participating in the trash off. It's important to keep our city looking clean. We also are trying to volunteer at the hospitality center more. Being there teaches us how to take little things like shoes somewhere to sleep or whatever.
Projects in progress. As we mentioned, we do have 7 projects currently in progress. Those would be Rescue the Memories, Ample Harvest, Teens in the Driver's Seat, Homeland Safety, Wise in My Eyes, Helping the Homeless, and Furry Friends. Rescue the Memories, we are trying to, right now, restore the park that's on Pleasure Island, the big wooden one. And we are trying to bring it back to what it used to be when we were little kids. I know right now it's kind of run down and it has graffiti and everything. We just want to bring it back to when we remember it, as it was fun and stuff like that.
And one of my favorite activities is Wise in My Eyes, where we go to the nursing home and make sure that, since the elderly, they don't have company whenever they go in the nursing home, we're there to keep them company, and it goes to my heart, because, it goes to my heart, because it's hard to see them like all lonely there, and
my favorite one would be the teens in the driver's seat, as she explained before, that is where you wear the drunk goggles. It also promotes driving safely for teens, which I am, and it's important for me to know all these things so I can be a better driver and I can be more alert and aware.
Our next activity is Furry Friends, where we go to our animal shelters and we donate items to the local dogs, because sometimes the animal shelter, they don't really have support from their local community. So we like to go and donate items to their animals, so they will have a hard time.
And then there's helping the homeless. And we're trying to currently start a blessing bag for them, which will have essential items that we take for granted, such as a toothbrush, toothpaste, socks, gloves, a shirt, some shampoo, deodorant. And basically, we're out in the communities trying to help them and let them know that just because they've fallen right now, it doesn't mean that they have to stay there.
Oh, and our homeland safety. As you all know that we live in the coast and we have hurricanes and I guess sometimes tornadoes. What we like to do is that we like to make sure that that our citizens of Port Arthur are safe, and so we like to check our local weather, all to, like, so during, like I say, hurricane season or tornado season, like the past 2 months, I'd say, we've been having horrible weather, so we like to make sure that they are safe, and we like to bring I work out with our local fire department and we're trying to start our own CERT team to help our citizens in their need.
And this is our summary. In conclusion, we are the future of Port Arthur, Texas. It is up to us to help it become the city it should be. Just because we're small high school students, it doesn't mean that we don't have the power to make a change in the community. And that's what we're striving for right now. We want to change the negative comments that is surrounded by Port Arthur. Oh, you go to Memorial. Yes, I go to Memorial, and I'm proud of it.
And we have a lot of heart in everything that we do. We like to stretch it out more so that everybody can see that what we're doing in this small town.
This is Solandra's Love, and her project was called Career Investigation. Now, the project that you just heard was a chapter in review, and they gave you just a little taste of kind of buffet of everything the club's doing. But hers is centered around the career that she wants to go into.
Thank you. So I did my PowerPoint presentation on career investigation, and I titled my own matter, and I'm exploring the career of a developmental psychologist. This is just my table of contents. This is basically everything I'm going to talk about and on the slide. This is the LCCLA planning process. I identified a concern. My concern was to basically I just want to know, like, what does it take to become a developmental psychologist? What do they do? And show some details of being a developmental psychologist. I set a goal. My goal was to go online, do some research, find out what schools offer a PhD in psychology. I researched the salaries, the duties and responsibilities of a developmental psychologist, the advancement opportunities, the entry level positions, and the job outlook. And step three was form a plan. I did the research. I wanted to talk to the psychologist that worked at the Gulf Coast Medical Center, but I didn't get a chance to. And I researched universities that had psychology programs. And I asked Ms. Voss to take me to the library to get me set up and ready. I fully analyzed the rubric and got a full understanding about my struggling, and I did a lot of research online. And the follow-up was, it was just basically like the thanks. And showed me like 20 occupations that were most likely, and the number two occupation was a clinical psychologist. And this is just the duties and responsibilities of a psychologist. Psychologists do both basic and applied research, serve as advisors to communities and organizations. They diagnose and treat people and teach future psychologists. Do a lot of research over the mind and why do people behave the way they do, or why do girls act a certain way, or why boys act differently. And this is just the job description. Psychologists study the mind. Their research helps us understand behavior, memory, and mental health disorders. Throughout the counseling and experimentation, psychologists work to promote safety, understanding, and developmental health. The developmental psychologist is basically investigating how and why humans change over a period of time. It starts when you're an infant and continues throughout your lifespan. It is a very fascinating area because you can do a variety of things. You can focus on language development and study why children's speech may not reflect their thinking. You can look at an adolescent and the problems they have in establishing identity. And just, these are the entry-level positions. A social worker, a career counselor, a probation officer, or a secondary education administrator. And this is the advancement opportunities. There are a variety of opportunities for advancement in the field of psychology. Psychologists in advanced positions may move up to the university administrative lab to the chair department dean or president. And this is the job outlook and understanding. The job outlook, psychology graduates generally report being pleased that what they study in school has helped prepare them for both life and work. As a woman who opened her business shortly after earning a bachelor's degree in psychology studies, after all, psychology is the big $25 per hour. And this is Dr. Pamela Twyman Reed. I really admire her because not only because she's African American, but because she's a developmental psychologist. And she has always been interested in science since she was a young girl. She wanted to be a medical doctor, but when she got to school, all her friends were taking psychology as an elective, and she soon did too. And she fell in love with psychology, and she switched her major to psychology. And she has done research on why girls act a certain way. And this is not for the schoolwork. I had psychology my junior year, and I had child development. This is Maslow, the pyramid of Maslow. And we just basically have to draw the ladder and the different levels. At the bottom is psychology needs, which is like things you think you need, like ice cream. Second level is safety needs, like things you need to feel safe, like a bear, or a pillow, or security at home. The third level was, is like when you need love, or you need your family. The fourth level is like how you need.
Allen. She actually transferred into the district midstream, so she didn't get to go to region with us. We were already headed there, but she's very excited about FCCLA, and she came with a project that she had created in the previous school she was in. She's very interested in resurrecting fashion design back into the schools, and that's, of course, sewing and marketing with fashion. Cassie Allen.
Good evening, my name is Cassietta Allen, and my presentation is on bringing back fashion design class in ISD Memorial High School. Why do we want to have a fashion design class? Well, I can answer that question. Picture yourself as an 18-year-old who just got out of high school and have no job, and the only money you have is the money your mom or dad gave you. You would go into a panic and wouldn't know what to do, right? But what if you took design class? You would know how to use architecture design, then you would be able to start up the construction on your house, then you could use your interior design skills and make the furniture yourself or buy some. You could design inside of your house. The fashion design unit would help you design your own clothes, and you won't even have to buy any clothes. You can also make things that fit your style. It would save a lot of money. For many young children, school is an exciting place, especially primary grades, are eager to observe new ideas and information. But how many of them still feel that way when they become teenagers? Research shows they grow into teenagers and get in high school to often lose their spark and their interest in learning and desire. By high school, a significant number have dropped out, viewing school as boring and frustrating, and the content as irrelevant to their lives, with no intent for their futures. For kids, if they had their interest in school, then they would have motivation to keep going. Studies from student surveys show they aren't interested in school because they're bored and that they like their electives more than regular classes. The Bureau of Labor Statistics concludes that high schoolers start to plan their career in high school. That would mean students would need to be open to multiple decisions. Would school be so boring if you had something to look forward to? For kids, if they had their interest in school, then they would have motivation to keep going. So I would say yes. In school, on average drops out as they move from the elementary school into the secondary school system, says Jaquelin Estes, PhD, education professor at the University of California. You see it in attendance, in getting in trouble, in dropping out from high school, and also in dropping out of college because of non-motivation. Although designing can be difficult, this can give students a chance to apply their designs not only on paper, but on clothes, creating buildings, inside homes, and on computers. Fashion design will teach you how to style yourself professionally. Architectural design will instruct you in the art of designing buildings. Interior design will teach you the art or process of designing, decorating the interior of a house. Throughout history, designing has greatly influenced the fabric of society all around the world. When people associate themselves with creativity, making their own decisions, they feel a sense of confidence that is not found when they don't. 73% of teen girls suffer from low self-esteem and low confidence because they're scared of showing their creativity. It is a fact that most primary schools and secondary schools are teaching us teenagers, in other words, the next engineers, the next teachers, the next doctors, to combine their creative nature. They are teaching the future generation that creativity is a distraction. Design class, fashion design class, can give us the chance to build our new Eiffel Towers, Taj Mahals, decorate our new Four Seasons hotels, and last but not least, design new trends. The whole point really in fashion design class is not just to better prepare us for future careers we may want in these fields. It is also to reinstall the creativity that some students may have lost along the way of constantly being told to stay in straight lines, be reminded to stop talking, and the pressure of making good grades. Why is it important to have a design class? Many other schools have design class, and look how successful those schools are. I think it is important to have a design class because many kids like design, such as architecture, makeup, interior, and fashion. If we had a design class, it will prepare many kids for college because many kids start looking for a career. Design class is not beneficial for everyone, but it's beneficial for those kids interested in makeup, interior, graphic, and architecture design. Many kids would like to have a career in these units, and this class will be definitely help a lot of kids in the long run. Kids will have an opportunity to learn about something that is interesting to them. They will learn how to design and how to feel and express themselves throughout their designs. They will also learn how to put the uses they learn and make it beneficial for their life. There won't be a lot of homework. The only homework you will get is going home and finishing the rest of your designs. We will have a fashion show at the end of the year filled with everyone's designs. There are many ways that fashion design class could contribute to the schools. The students in design class can help design school websites, t-shirts, and posters. They can help raise money through fundraisers. If someone becomes famous off their architect, makeup, interior, or even fashion design, it will be a very good look for the school. Why I want to bring back fashion design class? I don't think any of you know, but there used to be a design class previously. I think we should have design class because many people are interested in it, such as myself. Many people need a way to escape from the real world. This class could help them do that. It will let them do what they are good at and help them find who they are as a person. Many people want to be more involved with school, and some people even try to be more involved, but they can't. Why? I can tell you why. Because they're not interested in those things. I know there's a lot of clubs, such as Key Club, Student Council, National Honor Society, football, soccer, softball, and baseball. Not all people are athletic or super, super smart. There are other people who are super artistic, and what is the only classes they have? Art. They want to have more classes that speak to them. In many opinions, they should not have taken away design class. Many people want to do things that can express how they feel. Parents should like this class because it teaches students how to design almost everything in the world when students are out of high school and on their own, possibly have kids. They can make clothing for their kids and learn how to fix their child's clothes and fix their own clothes. In the end, it all comes down to what you think. In my opinion, I believe we should have this class. People want something that will help them get through high school, emotional-wise, like I said earlier. Fashion design can help you express yourself emotionally, and also the other units in this class. But when you think about it, the whole entire world is based off designs. Someone had to make those clothes you had on. Someone had to construct the most important buildings of the world. They created all these websites you go on, those video games you play, those people that actually created those designs. These schools you're sitting in started from somewhere. They had to try again, several times. If you don't consider design class, now you're stopping from someone from being the next big thing. You're stopping the student from becoming successful, and I know you care about your students' academics and if they're successful.
Next student is Danielle Aranda, and her project was based on entrepreneurship.
My name is Danielle Miranda, and I did a project on entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship means owning a business or being a business owner, and my business would be Amai Cafe. Amai means sweet in Japanese. This is my table of contents. My planning process. My concern was to show what it'd be like to own a business and what goes into it. My goal was to be more knowledgeable in this route of business and try to create a successful one. My plan was to research every aspect of it, complete all the requirements, and work on it now and at home. And my app was, during the middle, I changed my frequency according to my schedule rather than how it would be ideally. I learned various new aspects of the business industry, and if I were to do this PowerPoint again, I would start it earlier and spend more time with it. My business description. My name of the business would be Amai Cafe. My mission statement would be, it is our objective to continue to quickly provide high quality services as well as seamlessly provide error-free products. My services provided would be homemade pastries, a variety of drinks, including coffee, lattes, hot chocolate, and soft drinks or juice. We will also have free Wi-Fi to customers and a meal plan for the homeless who are looking for a warm place to stay for the time being and want to go and drink. My business hours would be Monday to Thursday, 6 a.m. to 5 p.m., Friday to Sunday, 10 a.m. to 10 p.m. It would vary slightly on holidays, being Sunday to Thursday, 6 a.m. to 10 p.m., and Friday and Saturday, 8 a.m. to 11 p.m. My demographics will be strongly focused on the priorities of children and young people. In my facility, I'll be by Highway 365 in front of Central Mall. My space would be 4,800 square feet, 1,920 feet for the dining area. And 2,880 for the kitchen. My utilities would be basic, water, gas, and electricity. My emergency procedure would be to secure everything as well as I can and lock everything up. My maintenance, I'll just schedule a maintenance person to come in once a month to check everything is working fine and as it should be. I only had one supplier here in the area, and that is Zeno's, and that is their information. And my equipment would be ovens, proof boxes, baking sheets, racks, mixers, burp tables, sinks, sugar sculpture box, a coffee machine, an espresso machine, a soft drink machine, and an ice machine. My description for provisions of maintenance would be the repair person should be able to cover that, and it should be fairly easy to conduct this type of business. My organizational chart. I will have an owner, a shift leader, a baker, a food preparation associate, cafe attendant, and a janitorial attendant. They're pretty self-explanatory, but the owner owns the establishment, the shift leader directs fellow employees to do routine and make sure customers have a satisfactory experience. The baker obviously bakes. The food preparation assistant greets customers, rates up purchases, answers questions. The cafe attendant will basically have the same thing, and the janitorial is maintaining the clean and orderly dining area and kitchen area. That is the hierarchy, the order being on top, the shift leader a step below, and they can both govern baker, cafe attendant, and the janitorial. Personal management. The hiring procedures will depend on the position, but the general layout would be as follows, with defined key objectives for the position, a thorough job description, and a complete screening process. The salaries and benefits will also be depending on the position, but I will be using minimum wage as a starting point, being $7.25 in Texas. The key job descriptions. The owner will have administrative support and receptionist, marketing manager, will be a bill collector, accountant, business planner, lawyer, kind of, they have to understand the laws, manager, tax collector, and technical support. The baker performs most of his or her work independently or as part of a close-knit team. The cafe attendant are responsible for cleaning tables, taking dirty dishes to the kitchen, refilling glasses, and seating customers. The shift leader will direct other employees to do daily routines and interact with customers to make sure that they have a satisfactory experience. They will also act as quality control, ensuring customer satisfaction through training employees properly and adhering to company policy. The food preparation assistant, again, has to be in work areas, store food, prepare a variety of foods, package takeout foods, portion and wrap food, place food on trays, inform supervisors when supplies are getting low, weigh or measure the ingredients, and they can assist cooks and kitchen staff. Janitorial is in charge of keeping building clean and orderly condition, perform heavy cleaning duties such as cleaning floors, shampooing rugs, washing walls, and glass or removing rubbish. In order to get a praise in the business, you need to have positive reviews that far away the bad ones. My methods and sources of funding, for startup, I would need $10,000 to $50,000 depending on what I need and what I want. I will have money and I will probably get a loan from the bank. My budget, my income, and monthly unit break even would be about $17,255. And to be able to pay for everything, I would need nearly $48,000. My expenditures in year one would be $260,000. It goes up a couple thousand each year. My financial procedures would be to keep it short, sweet, short and sweet, and this is an absolute must when writing any internal procedure. I should be able to brainstorm the worst case and find ways to get through it. And if that doesn't work, if the worst does happen, I would ask who should be notified, how should they be notified, under what circumstances should the bank be notified. And if there's any dispute over the procedure, where is the procedure resolved? This is the tax information, and prepared food is generally subject to veto tax. However, the law does provide an exemption for certain types of prepared foods like sweet bakery items. The laws, regulations, and codes. This is the Texas Administration Board, Title 25, Part 1, Chapter 228 in retail food, and there are subchapters titled A through J. In insurance, I will have three, and it is property, building coverage, and contents coverage. My local and county and state codes will be the International Building Code and all those other codes. That is the governmental contact information, which includes poison control, hospital emergency room, fire department, and police department. My marketing plan will be to create a design banner, promotion through local radio, word of mouth, and on holidays we will have special discounts and special decorations, some being as shown. And that is my website. Thank you.
Last but not least, one of the projects that the first group talked about was Teens in the Driver's Seat. This is a peer-to-peer program that we have on campus. We get a lot of promotional items. State Farm helps, and the Department of Transportation also helps us with the promo items. This is Rosa Jaramillo.
Jaramillo.
Thank you. And Kanisha Brown and Brittany Banks is going to tell you about Teens in the Driver's Seat.
This is a FCCA Planning Practice called the Identify Concert.
We will be identifying our concerns, which are
are addressing special needs, teens get killed by the distractions, sexting and driving, driving at night, drinking and driving, sleeping or racing, eating while driving. We as a community need to address the issue of teens in a driver's seat when they have one or more distractions. Do you know how many teens passed away in the recent years by distractions? Can you guess? That's cheating, you've looked. Okay, well, according to sources in the U.S., 5,864 teens drivers ages 15 to 20 were involved in fatal car accidents. Young drivers between 15 and 18 years old accounted for 6.4% or 13.2 million of total drivers on the road. This is why we are sharing this information of to teens to recognize their priorities about driving.
Target audience. This project was targeting to teens, young adults, and their parents because teens are getting killed in car crashes and we are here to prevent that. This involves teens, therefore they are the most at risk when driving. Teens are more likely to crash because they don't know the consequences of their actions on the road. We are here, we are also targeting parents because it's their responsibility to inform their child and make them aware of the different situations when driving.
Democracy through cooperative action in the home and community, to encourage individual and group involvement in helping achieve global cooperation and harmony, promote greater understanding between youth and adults, provide opportunities, making decisions and for assuming responsibilities, to prepare for the multiple roles of men and women in today's society, promote the family, consumer science and related operations. I'm sorry, this is dull. Is there a way to brighten it?
No, I love it. We have to turn the lights on again.
Relates to family and consumer sciences. In human growth and development, it states that using SCCLA's planning process to help teens make a more reasonable decision. We all know most teens have difficulty controlling their emotions since the is not well developed. And this
from a scope is plan to zero crazy census reopen. We also plan to have another census in the spring. What we will have done so far is fall zero crazy, fall census summit and primary.
Our project organization. In the fall, we decided to have a safety summit to keep our classmates informed, but there was a problem. The problem was that when people were giving us the equipment that I'm going to be very healthy, but the equipment together and take it.
Our corporate sponsors correspondence where AT&T, State Farm, Drive State, Nebraska Office of Highway Safety, Houston, Galveston Area Council, Texas Department of Transportation, Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration. And our partners that worked with us was Texas A&M Transportation Institute, which they gave us the equipment for the safety summit, Walmart, Petco, and PetSmart, which were the stores that they did fundraise in front of their store.
Our plan, we plan to do another safety summit in March and do another video here to spread the message, not just in Palo Alto, but around the world. We also plan to try different ways to get the message out, like on educational and awareness videos, and making sure that teens know the consequences of the actions by driving.
Our timeline, we did a park cleanup of September 2016. We had a TDS safety summit of October 2016. We started Zero Crazy in November of 2016. Started fundraising cupcakes for convention in December of 2016. And we had a Zero Crazy spring in January 2017.
Activities, tasks, and roles. Activities ATDS Safety Summit was presented at Memorial High School of MacArthur, Texas. We also had a Zero Crazy, which is we went outside and surveyed our classmates if they had their seatbelts on. We had to entertain the students at each station that we were on, and we set up equipment in our safety summit. Each one of us had to station in the parking lot and make sure that they had their seatbelts on. Task: we had to lead the students to different activities. For example, we had the drunk walk goggles, the go-karts drunk with the drunk goggles. Last year they had a awareness video that we used and we searched up on the internet. A virtual racing game with the drunk goggles and board games. And here are some pictures that we took during the safety summit.
But the equipment and formal items were given by the organization. We raised over 200,000 safety summits. We also want $100 gift card for the Zero Crazy fundraising cupcakes for cleaning.
Increase awareness, public relations. In Memorial High School, the audio class made an awareness video called Shadow Dreams, and it was about the consequences of driving and drinking. The boy who was responsible for the accident went to jail and killed the other person because of it. Here is a different video that has the same thing.
How sorry I am for letting you both down. You raised me well. You taught me to be smarter than this. You warned me during all those hours of driving practice not to drive distracted, but I didn't listen. I made the choice to drive with distractions, and it cost me all that. Cost me my life. Mom, Dad, I will always love you and be watching over you. But I need you to do something for me. Warn others about the dangers of distracted driving. Tell them to turn off their cell phones before driving starting September 17th as part of 17's 2-second turn off day. It takes 2 seconds to turn off a cell phone, but less than 2 seconds of distracted driving to get in a fatal crash. I don't want anyone to go through what I put you through. All the pain, the sorrow, the grief, the wishing that you could have prevented all this from happening. I may be gone now, but please don't let this happen to anyone else. Discourage destructive driving. Love you both dearly. Your beloved daughter.
Is so big, and this is something that the world needs more than anything. is the compassion to love one another. And you all have exuberated that today. And I want to appreciate you right now by telling you thank you. Because I needed that. You know, in being here, I will hope to see that our kids are growing. Because you're going to be the leaders. You're going to be sitting here one day making decisions. And thank you for looking out for your other classmates that are coming. You're a great example. Thank you very much.
To our sponsors and each student here today, you rock. You are the bomb. You are magnificent. You are Memorial High School proud. And thank you.
Young lady with the fashion design, stand up, where you at?
Fashion design, stand up.
I just asked Dr. Puerto Rico, and we look into that, because I think that is a nice thing to express ourselves. We never know when to have the next future great design in our school, so we definitely will be getting back with you about that.
Awesome.
Okay, next we will move to a closed meeting. Under the authority of Texas Government Code Sections 551.071 and 551.074 and 551.08282, the board will meet in a closed meeting to consult with attorney regarding pending or contemplated litigation, including settlement offers and other legal matters in which the duty of the attorney to the governmental body of the Texas Disciplinary Room Professional Conduct of the State of North Texas are clearly covered by attorney for client privilege. Next, we will consider personnel recommendations, Texas Government Code 551.074 as follows. Considering, if appropriate, approved employment of teachers. Considering, if appropriate, approved non-renewal of probationary contracts. Consider, and if appropriate, take action to non-renew the contract of non-certified, non-Chapter 21 contract employee. Consider, if appropriate, approve return to probationary status. Consider, if appropriate, approve renewal of probationary contracts. Consider, if appropriate, approve proposed non-renewal of term contract. Consider, if appropriate, approve renewal of term contracts for professionals. Considering, if appropriate, approve renewal of term contracts for administrators. Considering, if appropriate, take action to propose suspension without pay of professional employee. We will now move to closed session at 6:32 p.m. Thank you. We will now bring to open meeting at 7:27 p.m. Sorry for the delay. 27 minutes, but we had some pressing matters we had to take care of. We will start out now with public participation. The first person up will be Ms. Deborah Welch. Mr. Barty will take your time. We have 3 minutes to present. And at 1 minute, Ms. Welch, she will inform you that you have 1 minute remaining. It's good to see you, Ms. Welch.
Hi, I'm Gerald Welch, and this is Mary Owens. And we're with this organization called TREAT, and that is the Recreational Event Activity Team. And we're having a Spring Fest, April 15th, downtown in the pavilion. And we would like the board, I know that's going after Mr. Puerto Rico's requesting for a marching band. We're just trying to have a parade, but I don't think that's going to go off right now as a parade. We would like to have a choir there to sing. It's going to be a music fest with various music, church choirs, and we're going to have local bands, jazz band, and we're going to have vendors and carnival for the kids. And it's going to coincide with April the 14th, where the City of Clark had a movie at the park. So that whole weekend, like 14, 15, and 16, but 15 is just our thing, the Super Feast, Spring Fest. Any questions? That's April the 15th is the Spring Fest, the musical fest. Starts about 10 that morning. 10 to 8 on the weekend. And we'd like to also invite the board to come out. And it's going to be having city people there also. They're helping us out a lot, getting this together, with providing us with a lot of things. But that's what we did. And the purpose of this group is just to get things for families to get together, community. Because what we said is nothing to do with Port Arthur. And so just trying to bring up, have like a family day. Like I said, you know, have vendors and just to have fun. And this is our first one that we're getting together. We're rookies at this, and I've done this before. But we have Mr. Glenn Reed was with us, he's with the musical, so far it's going pretty good. Yeah, we had to ask, everyone requests, can we get the choir to be in the musical? So would you get back with me, because I know I gave you a letter earlier.
Yes.
So you get back with me and let us know, so Glenn, you put them on the agenda.
Please email. Okay, I will. Is there any questions? Anything? No, ma'am. Thank you. Just well, thank you.
All right.
Thank you. All right. Next up, we have Ms. Laura Hunter for public participation.
Good evening. As you all know, I'm Laura Hunter. I would like to say, after reviewing the records of the students at Memorial Night who have been retiring, it was noted that some students are repeating classes that they have successfully completed. I have conferred with my colleague, and she has explained to me that the students were not allowed to take advantage of the programs that are often in Port ISD for recovering credits and intervention. Therefore, must be rescheduling classes that they have successfully completed. I understand that MHS 9 counselors for the last 4 years have been forced to reschedule students in classes that they have successfully completed. This was due to no fault of the principal, counselor, nor students. From my understanding, Memorial Ninth Grade Academy and Memorial High School are listed as at the Texas Education Agency as one school. Since these programs, credit recovery, redirect, and reclaim, are offered for students in 10th through 12th grades with not the same programs, be offered to all students of grade 9. Since 10 to 12 is reclassified at the end of the semester, would the same apply to grade 9? Are the 9th grades entitled to the same viable education as 10 to 12th grade? If students in grade 9 are denied the right, are not afforded the opportunity to participate in courses that meet their needs and 10 to 12 are allowed to participate, would this not be considered arbitrary and capricious? Also, within the past 10 years or better, credits for semester courses and year-long courses have been awarded at the end of each semester, with the 90% class attendance rule being applied as well. Has there been a policy change in how and when the district applies the 90% rule and awards credits for year-long courses? If so, why was this not addressed in 2014 when MHS, discovered and reported that the 90% attendance rule was inadvertently calculated incorrectly, which caused some students to be denied credits for courses that they had successfully completed and impacted transfers for some of the students in the graduating classes of 14, 15, 16, and perhaps 17. How can these issues be resolved or prevented in the future? Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hunter. We will now have staff reports.
Thank you. We had some questions prior from the board about the elementary basketball league. So I'm going to ask Mrs. Chappelle to, I guess, tell us what you got.
Mr. Superintendent, Mr. President, Board President, I did review the documentation from the Port Arthur Elementary Basketball League. The league supplied me with their documents, and I looked at the board policies with regards to the use of facilities, and I did find that the league on February 7, 2017, filled out a requisition form for use of school property. It notated that the organization would charge $1 for admissions. It was approved by a principal, and I think it was a signature by a superintendent. I didn't know that. But it seemed to fulfill the requirements of the district with regards to our policies with school-related organizations or school support organizations. The league began February 13th, so that document was signed prior to the beginning of the league, from what I had to tell you with the documents. I did find that each parent of a student, or at least it seemed to be, from the documentation, seemed that at least 140 students from all the elementary schools of the district participated in this program. There seemed to be a sufficient amount of parent documentation or releases, even though that's not something that would be required by the school district. Because we're immune from any kind of injury that the students have occurred, but there at least seem to be a release signed by parents that release the Port Arthur Elementary School League and also the school district. I found that on February 23rd, this group actually created a board. I talked to the president, Mr. Antoine Freeman, and I talked to him about the elementary school league. I asked him with regards to what activity the district played in the league, and he informed me that each campus had a teacher representative who collected the forms, but that this league was run by volunteers and parents. The only people that are paid in this league, according to Mr. Freeman, would be the referees. The organization provided me with documentation that referees were paid after each game. Referees were required to sign for payment, and there was documentation with regards to what payment was received. They also provided documentation on collections at doors, which were signed by, it looked to be volunteers and individuals who were collecting money at the door with an amount. There were at least three occasions where the organization had documentation for concession stand proceeds, and that was documented also. I asked Mr. Freeman with regards to who ran the concession stand, and I also talked to Ms. Williams, who's also the treasurer or secretary for the organization, and they informed me that organizations come to men and ask to run the concession stand. There were at least three occasions when there was either not an organization running it, or on at least one occasion, I think Project Graduation was supposed to run it and backed out. And those three occasions, there were slips in the documentation that I received, counting what proceeds were collected. There was nothing there to document who purchased the proceeds for the concession stand. So I asked that question, and I was told that board members donated those items, and that every week or whenever the head came, and that that money was not deducted from any of the proceeds that this organization kept for the kids. They provided documentation with regard to their meeting where they set their board February 23rd, 2017, and also their minutes for that meeting and their budget. So I did review their collection with regards to how many students were listed as being in the program. It's seen that some of the students, you know, did not participate, some of the teams did not participate in providing any money for t-shirts, but they did provide receipts for t-shirts that were bought, and that did coincide with their budget. They provided information for the purchase of the decals that were placed on all of the shirts. And they also, on February 24th, after the meeting in which they voted on the 23rd, that they would open up an account with the school district. That's something that Dr. Porter Reed had asked this group to do because of the questions concerning it. But that's something I found that we've not, or that the district has not required any other organization, no PTA, no booster club, no project graduation, is required to do this. Mr. Antoine, who's also an attorney here in town, asked me about forming a nonprofit for this group, and so I will forward him the information to do that so that they would be able to function as any other parent organization for the in the school district. I did find that there was at least one other group using the school facilities that was not paying for school facilities, you know, in addition to project graduation, booster clubs, PTAs, PTOs. There is an AAU basketball team that uses one of the gyms to practice, but they do not pay fees. They have insurance, but they don't pay a fee to use your gym. That is the only other sporting group, but that group was not associated with any school, and the age of the kids, they were using a middle school gym, but the age of the kids were elementary school. So I don't think that they were associated with that school as far as I can find out. They do have permission to use it, they have been using it, and no one's instructed me to do anything about it. That is, in reviewing some of the groups, I did talk to the AAU teams that use your fields, and just to see what they were doing, and to see if they were different or alike with this program. And what I found is that this program, as far as I can tell, students were directly from the individual elementary schools, and then they came together to play each other. And that was different from the other programs that were, for say, the track club that's Foster Cross City, and the AAU ball teams that use your courts also, or use your fields also. With that, I know that as a part of their budget, their ending balance this year seemed to be around $250 after they pay coaches, and I did verify with even some phone calls to some of the people who were listed as not coaches. Coaches are volunteer referees, that referees were being paid, that their ending net was about $250. And what Mr. Freeman informed me was that this week apparently is their final week or their championship. I think today is a championship. And that they were feeding all 140 of the kids. Everyone will receive a trophy. Everyone will receive a t-shirt. And the champions will receive an additional medal. So with feeding the kid 140 kids at $240, I don't think, as far as I found, they were not planning to get any other revenues at this game today. With that, that's kind of what I found out as far as your policies are concerned and whether this league fit within your policies with regards to the use of your school.
Do we have any questions from any board members?
Yes, I do, of course I do. Thank you, Mr. Chappelle, for that update. The question I have is why now? Why fall aboard now? We've been operating this way for 10 years. The questions that I brought to the board, the questions that I have today, and, are simple. One, why are we spending so much energy to justify a program that's an after-school program that has nothing to do with the school district at all? This doesn't even, in fact, this doesn't fall under any umbrella. There is other programs, Pop Warner programs, that cater to exactly the same students. The fact is, they pay. The Little Titans pay for utilization of facilities. AAU teams that you spoke a moment about, when they have tournaments here, they pay for access. So my question is real simple. Why is it okay for Mr. Lofton to have access to these facilities at no charge and charge the person that you're talking about that has that use AAU gymnasium? They're using it at no charge, but they're not charging anybody. They're just using the facility. They're not making any money off the facility. They're not making any money off the district. So that's the question. That's the question goes on and on. Looking at this newspaper article, Ms. Lofton stated here that he had been doing this for 10 years, operating a business on our facilities for 10 years. No one said anything until I said something. I spoke with Mr. Freeman, Ms. Angela Freeman. We spoke over the phone, and he told me what he was going to work with Ms. Lofton in doing. Same question to him. Why now? If he wasn't doing anything wrong, why now? Looking at what the superintendent stated, which I found real odd. I mean, we even having this discussion here now about it when we could have took care of this 2 months ago. In a written response to the news, Portery said that the basketball program is an extension of the district's after-school tutorial program for students that need an extra instruction during the school day. The after-school elementary basketball program is a school-sponsored event. Now, in this same article, one of the elementary school principals said that it wasn't. And you just stipulated a moment ago that it wasn't part of our program.
No, sir. As part of this program, it's my understanding is that these students are required to be signed up in the after-school programs in order to participate in basketball. If the principals monitor the grades and conduct of these students, and if their grades are not appropriate, if their conduct is not appropriate, then they're not allowed to play. So it is a part of.
So where's the documentation that proves what you're telling me today?
I don't have any documentation. I'm telling you what my interviews are with the principals and with the parents who are involved. This would be, in my opinion, would be no difference in any other parent organization. The only thing is that your district cannot take on a athletic program such as this as a district activity itself. It can be a support activity run by parents and volunteers, because otherwise it would violate UIL rules. You cannot, as a district, have district employees, district coaches, or people acting as coaches and things like that, unless they're a parent of a student.
When Dr. Portery spoke about this being a sponsored program, is that true or not true?
I think it is sponsored. It's my opinion that is a sponsored program, just like a project graduation would be, just like a PTA would be, just like a booster club would be.
So what you're suggesting now is that all the programs that meet the exact same criteria that Mr. Lofton, they should also be entitled to use those facilities at no charge as well.
If the criteria is that they are a school-sponsored program or a PTA,
this is an after-school extracurricular activity that has nothing to do with education.
Well, that's your opinion.
No, it's not.
But it's the district's job to decide what is school-sponsored and what is school-related. It's the board's job to pass a policy, and this is what the policy says.
Taking this fight up to sell the city on a program that, according to the GE policy, GE local, GKD local, it states that we cannot do business with for-profit individuals or organizations. That's number one. That's part of it.
That this is not a for-profit organization.
He just said he made a profit because he made a donation to AAU, and he also made a donation to Project Graduation. I have the article right here, ma'am.
I did not say that. I don't know what your article says, but I did not say that.
Would you like to see the article?
No, sir. I did not say that. What I found is that AAU teams and Project Graduation have been allowed, and other further organizations have been allowed to run concessions.
Ms. Lofton, Ms. Lofton admitted to put out the news in an interview that he has made donations. Now, all I'm asking for is documentation. I mean, with this going on for 10 years, I'm sure there'll be some documentation where the same things have happened. If he's ran his organization for 10 years, then there should be some documentation, some financial statement somewhere, somehow, to show where the money's gone. Now, on any other school-sponsored program, it's always been district employees operating.
No, sir.
Every basketball game, I went to, I see district employees.
But
every
football
game, I went to, I see district employees. Every fundraising event with, I see district employees. Tell me at which point district employees are not involved.
Okay. District employees are not involved in Project Graduation. District employees are not, as a part of a parent PTO, are not involved unless they pay dues. They're not members unless they pay dues. Your Project Graduation does fundraisers, even at your football games. But if you're talking about athletic activities, your district cannot be involved in a league on the elementary level because that would violate your UIL rules. So the only way that a league such as this, and you're not the only school district that has this kind of elementary league, but the requirement is that it has to be run by parents. It can't, and a parent can be an employee of the district, but they also have to be a parent. You can't take your coaches, as you're talking about any other, your middle school level or your high school level, and have actual coaches that you're paying to be a part of a program like this, an athletic program on the elementary school level. You have fundraisers with PTAs, that they do not account to this district. They do not have accounts in this district. As far as I know, this is coming up now because you sent a letter that I received a copy and was asked to look at the policies regarding this, and you asked for a report to be made with regards to whether there needed to be a change in the policy. What I found, Mr. Lofton is not a member of this board, and you as board members are still individuals and your parents and
you volunteers. Point is, Mr. Lofton has been in charge and been responsible for
this program
for 10 years.
Not on this program. He is not.
He may not be as of February 23rd of 2017, but he was last year, the previous 9 years, man.
And
here's what I'm suggesting. What I'm asking here is financial records that's going to show, number one, what money was collected, and if this is a district-sponsored program, who authorized Mr. Lofton to disperse those funds? Why wouldn't those funds turn into the financial department, to Ms. Jean? So, I mean, there's a whole lot wrong with all of a sudden, as of February 2017, we formed a board.
I don't know anyone else, it's just kind of
odd that we do it now because questions have been brought up about it. The fact of the matter is, it is not a school sponsored program. It's no more of a school sponsored program than Pottawatomie Warner Football or Little Titans and any other organization that are sponsored by parents and volunteer coaches like myself. And we pay. I've paid, we've paid. So my question still stands, and my opinion is that this is a biased program. It's a good program for the kids, but it only caters to 210 to 240 students. What about the other students that don't play basketball? What about the other boys and girls that would like to have an extracurricular activity such as this that pulled up the Parks and Recreation Center has a vast program that the district ought to be partnering with that has insurance and all that, that relieves the liability that where the parents want for, what about signing a waiver? Why not go that route? Why support something that doesn't include all the kids? Because you guys are making a real good case and proving a point that I made earlier. There's something wrong with that. And to have it on the agenda, only speaks volume that it implies implication that there's something that was wrong with the idea. And now you're trying to clean it up. Now, I don't appreciate that. I don't think the citizens of Port Arthur appreciates that, you know, making this grand effort to clean something up that should have been done right from the beginning.
Okay. Mr. Reed.
Mr. President, I want to call a point of order, and here's why. It's my understanding that this is simply a staff report. I think we're getting to an area of a discussion and possible action. So even though I'm not wanting to argue with Mr. Guillory about what he wants to discuss, that's just the point. It becomes a discussion. This is a staff report, and it just appears to me that we're getting a little bit off the agenda. Perhaps this is a matter that for the next meeting should be put on the agenda as discussion of possible action, because now we're diverging from our agenda, but this was just simply a report that the
attorney was something that is not even a program. When was it approved? What board said it? What board approved it? Which board, which year, which group of board members said that this is a program?
But wouldn't that be a matter for discussion rather than
then it should be on the agenda.
Report?
Well, Mr. President, I think, Robert, I have to take a difference with you because it is a staff report. You are able to ask questions when we have staff reports given to the public, the general public. These are some of the questions that Dr. Porter asked our legal advice to bring back to the board, and that's what she did. She gave a report. I think the question and answer that Mr. Guillory is conducting is valid because he's asking some of those tough questions that we need here as a board. And Dr. Porterly initiated by putting this on a staff report with the elementary basketball league to show just cause of what actually the league is doing. So I don't think it's fair that we would have to put it back on the agenda to state that, you know, a possible action on anything, because to me it already seems that this action has already been formulated because it's, from what our attorney says, it's an outside organization with the board with financial reports.
I respect what you're saying. It just seems like the nature of it is becoming more of a discussion to me. That's my opinion. And I think it's in the wrong place right now. A report is just simply that, a report. Any questions to me would be for sake of clarification. And I think some of the questions are not really about clarification as much as they are, it seems to be, either a point trying to be made or even arguing against some of the aspects of the report. My opinion.
Robert, if you don't mind, sir, when you have an opportunity, check out GE Local and read it for you. So GE Local, CFK, CKFD, read it for yourself and you'll see that there's nothing there that says how and or who we should or should not charge. And there's nothing there that says that Mr. Lofton's program is to be charged or not charged versus someone else's program. Everyone I spoke to stated that they have a contract with the district. They paid the district. They have insurance for their kids, whoever is involved in their program. Now, When the same thing was asked of Mr. Lofton, Dr. Portery stepped in at his aid or rescue to say that he doesn't need it. According to this article, why doesn't he need it? He's dealing with the same kids when these other programs, they need it for the protection of the parents and the kids.
I'm not disputing your right to make those points, Mr. Guillory. My only point is that I think we're getting away from the nature of the staff report. Now we're going into a totally different area that should be, for the sake of order, should be in a different location on the agenda. We're now getting to the point of discussion about it, and because we're elaborating on it rather than just reporting and asking questions for the sake of clarification. I think we're stepping out of bounds on the agenda right here.
I want to ask the staff report that I've got a text message not too long ago that Lucius Adams won a championship for the elementary league, and that I think on tomorrow they're going to have a pep rally at school for the kids because of this program that's been, to me, been successful for the past few years. I talked to the principals and also some of the parents of the kids, and they're very excited. They were very excited for this. They look forward to this every year, this basketball league for with elementary, because they have anything to do, and they look forward to it. And I want to just thank you, Mr. Lonathan, for bringing this to the district and to our kids as well.
Do we have any more questions on the staff report?
Can I suggest to us that in light of all that has happened and transpired with in regards to Ms. Chappelle bringing to us her findings concerning this, and Mr. Hillary, you're passionate about this, can I submit and suggest that perhaps we can work from here doing all the things that Ms. Sarah and Ms. Chappelle. Ms. Chappelle made the statement that Mr. Freeman, who is an attorney, and others are seeking to bring all of the concerns that any of us might have to the forefront, and causing the program to continue and to be successful, while at the same time adhering to the policy to which you refer. So, would it be possible at this particular time that perhaps we can all come together in some regards and cause the program to continue in light of all of the findings that Mr. Bill has made, so that we can do that? Would that be possible?
Trustee Frank, I've never disagreed with the philosophy behind the program. I was only concerned with how the program was operating. Because our kids and our children, they need as many programs to keep them busy as possible. But then there is the right way to get it done and the wrong way. And
well,
the
way we've done that is my recommendation.
Yeah. So moving forward, I can see light at the end of the tunnel. But looking back, as I stated before, there's some problems that we've had, and that the whole purpose of this was to address it and to get it fixed.
And you and I, it's been discussed. We've had the discussions. You brought those concerns to bear, and they need to be brought to bear, because as a trustee, you have a concern. You levied that concern, and so I'm saying from this particular point going forward, maybe we can work on causing it to be all that it has been designed to be.
As far as the policy is concerned, I believe that some adjustments are going to be made, because if you have access to that facility, a perfect example, we had a discussion the other day. If you had opened your doors for me to use one of your facilities, and all of a sudden you show up and I'm making money off of something that you let me use, and I'm not giving you none, that would be a problem. So what I'm going to suggest as we move forward and make a recommendation to the board, if you receive the benefit of utilizing the facilities at no charge, then you can't charge, because you don't have any liabilities. The liability and the responsibility is on the district. Now, if the district wants to foot that bill and spend the taxpayers' money that way, that's okay. But the other paying parents should have something to say about this as well, because their children are involved in other programs that a fee is assessed. So there is a difference, a fundamental difference in what we're discussing right here. Who's entitled and who's not entitled? Who should pay and who shouldn't pay? So as long as those things are, those stipulations are covered, and all of us agree that this is the best way for the district to move forward, I have no problem.
But let me say this though, and I want to as well give validity to Mr. Reed, Trustee Reed, because I agree with him that we have ventured off into the weeds a little off of the agenda as far as this being a staff report. But if I'm correct, because you made the statement yet again, and I am, according to the staff report, no one made a profit, no one gained money.
It doesn't matter, sir. It doesn't
matter. I mean, but your allegation.
If you collect a dollar on the 4th and 5th grade, listen, here's our.
Wait, so I am going to ask Mr. Chuck Kelly to come and give us a bond report. The buildings are being renovated, the buildings are, schools are being built, and that is a good thing, so we are ready.
Mild winter that we've had and a lot of rain has allowed us to make tremendous progress on all of our projects. The Wilson Early College is going to be the first project that finishes, and that will be in June. And I know there was some discussion on previous meetings about the roofing on that project, and all the roof repairs have been done. We've had some limited rain that has tested the repairs, and the repairs are holding up really well. And then the next project that will finish will be Terrell Elementary School. They are doing great work on that job, and yesterday Harvey and I walked around with Dr. Chambers, and she's very pleased with the progress on the job. There's some site issues that she asked us to address, and the contractor's dealing with that now. The Memorial High School would be the next project, and that will finish in February of next year. And they have finished all the concrete construction. The steel erection is very near completion. And if you go by there in the future, in the coming weeks, you'll see the walls going out in brick on the outside, roofing. It's going to be very active on that site. Then the next two projects, as far as schedule and completion, are Travis Elementary School and Sam Houston Elementary School. Y'all were there for the groundbreaking a few weeks ago, and if you went by there now, you'd see a lot of concrete construction for the foundations and slabs. And actually, they poured the second section slab at Sam Houston today, and they're going to begin steel erection on that project within probably the next 2 weeks, I believe, 2 to 3 weeks. So that's going to look a lot more active. And lastly, Dowling Elementary School, we are working on the completion of the construction drawings, and that'll be going out to bid in April, about the end of April is what the plan is right now. And we're hoping to bring the successful bidder's proposal to the board in June, as it stands right now. And that project would probably be complete in, say, August or September of next year. As far as budget, we have contingency in each one of the construction contracts, and we've been working very hard to protect that contingency and not spend it. And right now, it looks like we do not expect to go over the GMP amounts on any of the contracts. Let's see. Anything else?
I could address. Did you say the Dowling building was going to be done by August or September next year?
That's the hope right now. And I will say, as far as schedule is concerned, with the amount of rain that y'all have down here is crazy sometimes. And until we get the slabs poured, we really cannot say with any certainty when the projects will be complete. Everybody's been kind of holding their breath on Sam Houston and Travis. Yeah, you know, we've made great progress, but if, you know, if we got an inch of rain in, you know, the next few weeks, it would be really hard on that scheduling. And Downey's the same situation. Until we get the grading done and the slab poured, it's really going to be hard to have a set schedule.
As far as
September is, you know, August, September of next year is what we're hoping. That project is smaller than Sam Houston and Travis, so it'll go a little bit quicker, but that's what it's
saying. When will the Woodrow Wilson building be ready for someone to go inside and take a tour of it?
Well, if you would like me to meet you out there, I'd be happy to go out there anytime. There's a lot of finish work going on right now. And it's pretty interesting to walk around inside the building. You can see a lot of the original structure. The acoustical ceiling is not complete yet, but a lot of the classrooms they're putting the ceiling out. So like I said, I'm happy to go out there.
Thank you.
And we are hoping, just to piggyback, we are hoping to have a huge opening, opening for the individuals and our children. Our students are going to be in there in August, so that's exciting. We want the public to come out, but that may be something that you do in July, a big 4th of July type.
Yeah, the admin staff is working on getting the furniture ordered for that project, so it's all, everything's coming together really nicely.
Any more questions for Marshall? Thank you, yes.
Okay, before we conclude our staff report, I just would like to add that on Tuesday, we will begin our STAR EOC testing. So we want to ask parents to work with us and make sure their children get a great night's sleep and that they are happy and loved, and for teachers to come and be very, very calm and patient with our students as they embark on STAR and EOC. So we're excited.
Thank you. Next we have minutes. Considered if appropriate, approve the minutes of the February 23rd, 2017 board meeting. Motion.
Second.
Motion was made by Mr. Reed and seconded by Mr. Kimball. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? It's passed. Next we have the consent agenda. The following items, which are the routine and or reoccurring nature, have been designated consent agenda items by the board president for policy BE local. All of the items in the consent agenda will be acted upon by one vote without being discussed separately, unless requested by a trustee, in which event the items or items will be withdrawn immediately for individual consideration in its normal sequence after the items not requiring separate discussion have been acted upon. Do we have a motion? What do we have in items to be pulled to discuss? We have an instant have a motion.
Yeah. I'll make a motion. I'll make a motion to accept the consent agenda as printed in the President's
office. I second.
I have a motion made by Dr. Kinlaw, seconded by Mr. Reed. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed say no. Next, we have personnel who are acting upon the separate. That's for it.
Yes. President Lofton. Yes. President Lofton,
I have given you the list of teachers and I'm asking for the consideration to approve teachers.
Mr. President, I move that the board approve the employment of teachers as presented by the superintendent.
Need a motion?
I'm sorry,
I need a second.
I second.
Motion was made by Don Franklin, seconded by Mr. Kinlaw, to consider if appropriate approval of employment of teachers. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Surprise.
Yes. I am asking for the board to consider the approval of non-renewal of probationary contracts.
Mr. Superintendent, I move that the board approve the non-renewal of probationary contracts as presented by the superintendent.
Session.
Motion was made by Donna Franklin, second by Joseph Gittery, to consider the appropriate approval non-renewal of probationary contracts. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Clerk Corrigan.
Yes, I am asking for the board to consider to take action to non-renew the contract of non-certified, non-chapter 21 contract employee.
Mr. President, I move that the board take action to non-renew the contract of a non-certified, non-chapter 21 employee presented by the superintendent.
I second that. Motion was made by Donald Franklin, second by Robert Reed, to consider and appropriate take action to non-renew the contract of non-certified, non-chapter 21 contract employee. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Passed. Dr. Corrigan.
Yes, I am asking the board to consider and approve to return to probationary status.
Mr. President, I move that the board approve the return to probationary status of employees presented by the superintendent.
Yes, sir.
Second.
Motion was made by Donald Franklin, second by Brandon Barty, to consider an appropriate approved return to probationary status of employees. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
And all opposed? It's passed.
Mr. Lawton, I am asking the board to approve the renewal of probationary contracts.
Mr. President, I move that the board approve the renewal of probationary contracts as presented by the superintendent.
I second the motion. Motion was made by Donald Franklin, second by Dr. Kinlaw, to consider if appropriate approval renewal of probationary contracts. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
President Balkin, I'm asking for the board to approve the proposed non-renewal of term contracts.
Mr. President, I move the board approve the proposed non-renewal of term contracts as presented by the superintendent.
Second. The motion. Motion made by Donald Franklin, second by Brandon Barty, to consider the appropriate approved proposed non-renewal of term contracts. All in favor, non-renewal of term contracts. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Mr. President, I'm asking for the board to consider and approve renewal of term contracts for professionals.
Mr. Superintendent, I move that the board approve the renewal of term contracts for professionals as presented by the superintendent.
I second that. Motion was made by Donald Franklin, second by Dr. Kinlaw, to consider if appropriate approve the renewal of term contracts for professionals. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Passed.
Mr. President, I'm asking for the approval of renewal of term contracts for administrators.
Mr. President, I move that the board approve the renewal of term contracts for administrators as presented by the superintendent.
Second. Motion was made by Don, seconded by Robert Reed, to consider and if appropriate approve renewal of term contracts for administrators. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Passed.
Mr. President, I'm asking that the board consider and take action to the proposed suspension without pay of professional employee.
Mr. President, trustees, I move that the board approve the proposed suspension without pay of a professional employee as presented by the superintendent.
Second that motion. Motion was made by Donald Franklin, second by Brandon Barty, to consider if appropriate take action to propose suspension without pay of professional employee. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? It's passed. Next we have discussion and possible action. At this time, we have discussion possible action items that have been placed on the agenda by Board Member Gittery. I need a motion to place this item on the floor first.
So moved.
Second. Mr. Gilbert, you will now discuss your item.
Dr. Warren, can you please tell us what is the role of the school board member?
Well, I'm going now. The role of the school board member, I'm going to just put in guess in plain terms, is to support the district and to pass policies for the district. And if there's anything else, the school board is responsible for policies for the district.
I would just say, Madam Chappelle, would you answer that particular question in a legal aspect? I know Dr. Porter had a public opinion, but as far as a legal aspect, would you be willing to answer that in the role of a board member?
Well, as you guys have had training, and I know I do training with you when you first get on the board, and you go to TASB training every year, and I can tell you exactly what the roles are. I think it's easier to tell you what your role is not. But according to law, I can tell you exactly what it says your roles are. Just a second. Adopting goals and priorities for the district and monitoring success and achieving them. Adopting policies that govern the district and reviewing those policies for effectiveness, hiring a superintendent to manage your district and evaluating that superintendent, adopting an annual budget and setting a tax rate, ensuring that communities can inform about the actions of the district taken in the community's behalf.
Thank you, Mr. Bill. And the reason why I'm placed on the board is some got lost in translation somehow, that our role. And I just want to clarify that the only power we have as board members is when we're sitting here at this bench.
Oh, that's true.
When we're out visiting schools, I stress the word visit. That's when we do visit, hey, how you doing, that type of thing. There is no reason, and I want to set the faculty and administrators all at ease when we're out and about, that you don't feel or become uncomfortable with the presence of the board member. We pose no threat whatsoever. We have no power when we're out and about. We are board members. We're there observing, and that's the extent of our responsibility outside of closed session and sitting behind the bench. What I do tell you is this. If it happens, it is your responsibility to inform us if this type of activity does occur. We are not investigators of this district. That's number one. And we may ask you a question, how you doing, how you feel, you know, what those things look like, and you're going to give us your feedback. But that's about the extent. Our responsibility is to work with the superintendent. Secondly, by no means at all should we ever meet with any administrators or faculty. That's not our job. Our job is to be with the superintendent. It, period. If it happens, should inform the board that that type of activity has occurred. We should not be granted any special privileges because we're a board member. When we do this, we volunteer our time because that's, and we do it for the love of the children. There shouldn't be anything else on our agenda but the children. We should not visit any campus without notifying the superintendent. I know how to do it, but now I send him a text and say, hey, I'm going to such and such. And he says, okay. And it's up to him that he want to inform the school of our presence. But that's what we should do. As I stated earlier, the only employee we have is a superintendent who sees to the day-to-day operations. So if you ever get confused about anything, refer that board member back to the superintendent. Now, school board members should not micromanage nor should they serve to advance their own political agenda. I think last year, being a newbie on the board, it was a suggestion here at the bench where I made a recommendation about housing and moving you know, make some things happen in the district, and there were some folks that wanted to know more about what I had to say. I was ostracized at that time and was told by one of my fellow board members that that shouldn't happen under no uncertain term And I was supposed to, at the time, Dr. Kilbaugh was the board president, I should make sure I followed all my information, arguing the permission of the city president. Now, this past year, the exact same thing happened with the exact same board member. And this is the reason why we want to make sure that there's no confusion in our roles. In order for us to become a collective board, we all must abide by the same rules. Otherwise, it doesn't work. We're just citizens, parents, vested stakeholders, when we're not in this board meeting. And that's it. That's what's the role of a board member. A fellow board member, you might have any other questions that you can add to that, maybe I might miss something.
Do we have any other discussions on this matter, other board members? No? We'll move, need a motion to place the next item on the floor of G Local, GKD Local, G Legal. Need a motion made.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Gilbert?
Yes, Mr. Bell, would you mind giving us the full version of G Local, GKD Local, as it pertains to our board policy?
I'm not understanding what you're asking me.
Would you read the policy?
I'm not going to read these policies. These policies, that would be 6 pages long.
No, not GE Local.
But you have to take the policy into context. I think all of you have your policies. It's not up to me to negotiate your policies for you.
It's not to negotiate, Mr. Bell.
No,
sir. We simply want clarity on the policy because...
I can clarify if you want to ask me a question, but I'm not going to read these. No, sir.
Okay. Well, can you tell me what GE policy covers?
Relations with parent organizations.
Can you tell me what GKD Local is?
Community relations, non-school use of school facilities.
What was it, I'm sorry?
It is community relations.
Oh.
So non-school use of school facilities.
Okay.
So this brings us back to the other topic that we were discussing earlier. Can you tell me where in that policy, G Local, GKD Local, that it says or it describes a program in which is suited not to be charged?
Yes, sir. If you look at relations with parent organizations, the elementary school league is a parent organization, same as PTA, Booster Club, Project Graduation. When you look at GKD Local, community relations with non-school facilities, it says fees for use. Those are the people that are charged. Community relations, non-school use of school facilities. So your AAU teams, who are not necessarily students of Port Arthur, who are not necessarily students at the schools, that they are participating. It says non-school users shall be charged a fee for the use of designated facilities.
So as long as you are a student in a district.
That's not what I said, no.
Okay, so tell me
it says relations with parent organizations.
Okay.
And the other says non-school use. So it doesn't mean that you have to be it doesn't go by whether you're a student in the district or not. I would certainly say that if you are an organization and you don't have students in the school district and you're using a facility, then you would fall under the community use, not a school use.
So what qualifies us to fall under school use exactly?
Because it doesn't say school use, it says a parent organization.
Okay.
Your policy says parent organizations.
So parent organization, meaning myself, my football program.
No. If you are a parent organization,
yes.
It means you are made up of parents of this school. You're
yes.
A parent organization. So if you're a parent organization and you are a non-profit,
right.
Then you...
Now, in order to be a non-profit, what's the classification of a non-profit? You have to have a 501(c)(3)?
No, sir. PTAs don't have necessarily have 501c3s in the project graduation policy doesn't either.
Okay, so anybody can claim that they're nonprofit?
No.
I'm confused.
I don't know how to explain that to you any way other than this policy covers relations with parent organizations. And we know that when we talk about a parent organization, we're talking about parents of kids that attend these schools, okay. Not just parents.
Parents, every student, every kid on my team is in this district, including mom.
And so, I've never looked at your program to see whether you should be paying for the facility use or not, Mr. Guillory. I was asked to look at this program because the complaint was made that this program should be paying fees. I don't have I am not biased on the program one way or the other. And I'm not associated with the program. And I don't have other programs that pay fees to this district that I would have a bias against a program that does not. I am looking at your policies. The board is to determine your policies. So this board feels that the elementary school league should be paying, then this board can make a resolution that the elementary school league should be paying to use your facilities. But it's up to this board to decide that. It's not up to me. I can only tell you what your policies say.
That's all I was asking. So if you don't mind, I'd like you to look at the other programs in the city of Port Arthur that also fall under the same category as a parent organization, and they should be entitled as well to the same treatment under the policy.
If the board would like me to do that, then that is what I would do. If I'm instructed to do that, either by the administration or by the board.
I would like to make a recommendation to the board to ask Mr. Bell to look into the other organizations around the city so that we can expose our children to more programs than just basketball. Would the board agree to do that?
It's not on your agenda. You can't take action item. That's not
on
your agenda.
You can ask to take action.
It says possible action.
It says possible action.
But what he's asking is not on the agenda. The only thing that's on this agenda is to discuss your policies.
So, discussing the policy as this applies to additional programs, would you be willing to consider under this policy other programs?
Can I ask you this question, Madam Chappelle?
Yes.
It says discussion, possible action. So but why wouldn't that be?
Because your agenda item is your three policies.
Right.
He but is asking for me to go and look at other organizations and see whether they should be paying or not paying. That is not on your agenda. That's
well,
not
the
something
board didn't
you
ask
have.
You, board did, I don't
the administration
remember,
asked
I don't
me
remember the board at all. Not one time I asked you to look into this particular item from Mr. Laughlin.
The administration asked
so now the administration is working for the administration,
you,
not the board.
I just told you that either the board has to ask me to do this or the administration has to ask me to do this. One or the other. It doesn't matter to me. But it's not on your agenda for you to take an action item. You can put that on your next agenda if you want to, but it's not on your agenda.
May I make a suggestion? I think in light of what has been asked, let me see how we can do that with our coaches. Yeah. I think that may be the best way to do that and then work with them. I'm sure they know the programs that are out there, our school coaches, and see exactly what's happening in elementary, and then try to figure out how, if any way, that we can incorporate some of these things. We need to work, we even involve the city. Mr. Jerry Smith, I think, is over recreation. And then we can work with him along with Mr. Sanders and try to figure out what is it in Port Arthur that we have that's already in place. And let's work, I think that's the little before anyway, to try to work with the city of Port Arthur in order to ensure that everyone has an opportunity. So if you all would like, I will get with the coaches. I'll even not forget with it no longer. Dr. Vine.
Yes, the coaches.
And
the city. Use all the gyms.
Yes.
in the school district.
Yes, well, these are some type of programs that we have, like the football, and maybe something
we have developed with the city too.
We do. Yes.
But I mean, some reason that relationship fell off,
yeah.
And this long-term program started. Mm-hmm. And so it was a transition. I don't know how it happened, but it happened.
Well, maybe it's something we can rekindle. I'm not sure, but let's at least look at what's out there and try to figure out how we can incorporate everything.
Sounds good to me.
Okay.
Okay, next we have for discussion, competitive bids for professional legal services was placed on, we need a motion.
So moved.
Second. We have a motion made by Joseph Gooder and second by Mr. Kenlaw on the floor.
The purpose of this is we haven't had a contract since 2008. And we really need to look at, I noticed the last couple of months before it somehow got in the newspaper, but the fees have dropped almost in half on this particular agenda here and one of the previous agenda. I really do think in the best interest of the district that we ought to consider looking at other options as far as legal services any other services that we haven't looked at in some time. There's some programs that we also maybe need to review. We're not utilizing in the entirety. But in this case, I make a recommendation to the board to look into the competitive bid for professional services at this time.
Where are we at, President Lofton? I guess the board instructed you on 2 months ago to get with the attorney about our contract because it's outdated we had renewals. What's the date?
2008.
Okay.
What's the last time?
We talked in January at the board. So
yes.
Where are we at? And have you got with the attorney with the new contract to present to the board because it's been 2 months since then?
I don't have the contracts of the professional services. That's not my job as the role of the president.
No, it is your job, and it deals with the attorney. The attorney, the board talked to you 2 months ago and said.
And it's not my job to.
Well, whose job is it?
It's the superintendent's job. It's not my job to say if she's the attorney or not. We as a collective board.
But that's what we had asked you to do as a board.
So it's on the agenda item today.
Where is that?
I mean, not the agenda, right here for possible action.
Well,
so we either can bring it up for competitive bid. If we vote to bring it up for competitive bid, then the contract will come up and we will vote to have the district go out for competitive bids.
Well, first of all, let me say this, we can't go out for competitive bids under professional services.
Then what's the protocol?
We have to go out for proposals.
Okay, then proposal.
So where are we at? Excuse me, I'm sorry. What was the purpose of us 2 months ago in January asking President Lofton to get with the attorney to come up with an up-to-date contract? And I don't think it's fair to the public that we have a contract that's been outdated since 2008.
Let me say, question, Madam.
Go ahead.
What is it that makes the contract out of date when there's no ending date on the contract?
It's 2 years.
It's 2 years?
It's a 2 year contract.
No, it's not a 2 year
contract.
Well, what?
It's a 2 year contract. She stated it and it also read as a 2 year contract.
Help me understand, Trustee Frank. So, why can't we just get an up-to-date contract?
Or but they keep saying it's obviously up-to-date.
The signed contract that we have currently with our attorney for legal fees, or whoever's represented us legally, what is the ending date on that?
Mr. Shapiro.
What is the ending date?
Do you have an end date on your contract?
It renews every 2 years, unless you guys cancel.
So we can cancel it at any time?
According to the terms of the contract, yeah.
If we purchase.
Yeah.
Yes.
So there's
really no date, it's just whenever you
want to
end.
He said, maybe you can get another copy of it, because I think my man misread what was written, but I understood it to be activated in 2006, for 2 years and expired in 2008. And that's just my, let's just get another copy of it.
We'll agree to do that.
So we can all look at it. I would recommend it if it's possible, Gene, to get us a copy of it.
I've never known for a contract with professionals or professional services to have a culminating because for a professional service, that individual serves at the will and discretion of the board.
Well, let's do this, if you wouldn't mind, Trustee Frank, wait till we get a copy and we all can review it, and then Dr. Corey, would you put this back on the agenda so we can discuss it for next month? So we can get more clarity, because I was under the impression, we talked about this in January, that President Lofton would deal with our attorney. Now I'm hearing something else.
Yes. Well, the other thing is, I think if this
is a tape recorder that we have an executive session, that's exactly what I just said. So if we're not saying that.
Bring it for a possible vote.
Well, this is the posting says competitive bids for professional legal services.
Mm-hmm.
So I believe that trustees. Wish is that we would, as a board, was it your who placed this on the agenda? So, Trustee Hillary, your assertion or your warning is for us to go out for competitive bids for professional services.
Yes, get several proposals to see where we are. I know that Robert, you have something.
Finish what you were saying. Go ahead.
Yes, I had heard Ms. Chappelle in my 4 years on the board say at least twice, and I won't say more than twice probably, with all due respect to my fellow board members here, that she is more or less an at-will employee or attorney for the board, a board arbiter at ISD. I know I've heard her say that twice. Now, on the agenda here, we have competitive bids for professional legal services. And since it's been brought up, I call for a vote on the matter now.
Mr. President, I make a question. You haven't put a bid out. How can you do that now? We don't have any other bids.
Well, put a bid out. No, sir, I think you're correct.
Okay.
Trustee Kinlaw, but the point is that to even put a bid out, we would have to vote to do it.
You're right. And it's not a bid.
So that's why I'm saying it's been brought up. We talked about it. I just don't see anything due to discuss. I mean, let's vote on it now.
So we have a motion on the floor by
Trustee
Reed to make a proposal for competitive bids.
Right, second.
And we have
wait, hold up, time. I need to make clarification on the motion.
The motion is to put a proposal for competitive bids. Not bids, I'm sorry, for competitive proposal.
To go out for competitive bids?
Yeah, for professional legal services.
Okay.
And it would be put on the agenda to go out and look for it's on the agenda now. It would be for the district to go out for competitive proposal.
Before you go any further, I want to agree with something that, and I'm Trustee Frank, correct if I'm wrong, but I do think you need to, before we vote, state it clearly.
Yes.
What we're now, let's put it in clear language right now.
That the district will go out for a competitive proposal for professional legal services.
Proposals?
Proposals.
Okay.
You can't say bids, it has to be a proposal.
You made your motion.
I made my motion that it be voted on.
That we'll be voted on, that we would go out.
I second Trustee Shree.
Proposal. Dr. Kinlaw second the motion. All in favor to go out for competitive proposals, for the district to go out for a competitive proposal. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
No.
The proposal for the district to go out for a competitive proposal for professional legal service was a vote of 2 yes and 4 no's. It did not pass. Next, we have information, Dr. Corey.
Okay, we have average daily enrollment, 8,761, average daily attendance, 92.14%.
We will now adjourn at 8:24 p.m. Motion was made, seconded by Donald Franklin, seconded by